Welcome back, everyone. We are in the middle of day two of theCUBE's live coverage of the Red Hat Summit Ansible Fest 2025 here in beautiful Boston, Massachusetts. I'm your host, Rebecca Knight, alongside my co-host and analyst, Rob Strechay. Rob, the keynote this morning, there were lots of new product announcements, and in typical Red Hat fashion, very pragmatic, very thoughtful about what are the problems we're trying to solve? What are the customers' pain points? And how can we tie these to real business outcomes?
Yeah, and I think, again, that's always been a hallmark of the keynotes. And also it's about simplification and how really to go on this journey. And I think, again, the journey has taken some twists and turns over the years, to put it mildly, but we have a great guy here to help us talk about
this. That twisting journey. We have, let me welcome to theCUBE, Ashesh Badani, Senior Vice President and Chief Product Officer at Red Hat. Welcome back to theCUBE, Ashesh.
Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Rob, for having me back.
And congratulations, you did a great job up there on
the main stage.
So let's talk in broad strokes. Red Hat now sits at the intersection of cloud, open source, and AI. How do you think about product strategy?
Yeah, big question. So we'll see. You can do it in 2 minutes and then we'll go into detail in any area you want. I think you saw some of that in today's announcements, right? One of the areas that I spent some time talking about was that when enterprises, you know, first went on any journey, right, they went down a traditional path, which we'll call more proprietary or closed. And we believe that in the long run, open wins. And so every time we approach any market with an open solution, with the community that stands behind it, we believe that's the right one. We saw that play out with Linux. Yeah, it's pretty clear, opens won. We've seen that play out with containers and Kubernetes. It's pretty clear, opens won there. And we think we're going to see that play out in both virtualization, which we talked about today as well, and AI. And so our announcements today, our sort of product arc is all about where our customers believing they need to invest in to make a fundamental change in their business, right? Both with the current business they have, but also look to the future. And how do we make sure we bring the power of open and community to it?
So I think, again, why don't we dive a little deeper on one of those in particular. We had SiriusXM on last evening.
Yeah.
They've made the move where they're going towards OpenShift virtualization. They're bringing things off of VMware and really gone down that path to help simplify their life from multiple different reasons beyond even just the licensing aspect of it. What are you seeing? Because I think what I love is the fact that Red Hat always goes with partners in this. So you had two announcements around partners. Stephanie was up on stage talking about that with Microsoft and with Oracle Cloud, with Red Hat OpenShift virtualization, which I look at and I go, the one that was like hit first, the Oracle one was very interesting because I'm like, wow. I'm like, that's impressive. How do you see that adoption has been going? You were talking, you had a lot of numbers in the presentation this morning. It seems like there's a lot of momentum with OpenShift Vert.
Yeah, well, thanks for asking. So it's a long journey. And I talked about that in the keynote today, right? It's been a long journey we've been on, right? Ever since, you know, the initial days from KVM, right, to where we got to or where we are at right now. SiriusXM, great example. They came to the keynote and our stage last year. And, you know, they're coming back just, you know, talking about how they continue the journey. So I think that's really important to understand. This is not like a one and done thing, right? This is a multi-year transformation that we're going on with customers. This year we featured today Ford and Emirates NBD. Again, great examples, right? In both cases, we've been working with them for 8 years now, right? So adopted RHEL, adopted OpenShift, you know, and now on the journey from transitioning from traditional VMs to our platform, and making the move, right? And they've been talking about, you know, migrating 9,000 VMs over. AMD came on, I don't know if you caught this, they talked about a 77% reduction in TCO going from traditional VM solutions to OpenShift Vert, right? In their case, running on AMD CPU. So I think it's really a powerful testament, right? Because we are building on the products, technologies that they've invested with us together, whether it's in Linux or in a container platform, and then moving on that journey towards virtualization. And then we can't get there without that ecosystem, right? Now coming back to your point, Rob. Anywhere at this point where RHEL or an OpenShift runs, OpenShift Vert runs. right? So Stephanie, I think, talked about both Oracle and Microsoft, but we already have it on AWS and on Google and on IBM Cloud, right? And on data center. So we're really trying to cover as broad a spectrum anywhere customers want to run hybrid cloud. We want to make sure our solution's available.
So, and I want to plug our coverage too, because we are going to be having Ford on later and Emirates. And so we are going to hear their customer stories and the journeys that they've been on, as you said. What are you hearing from enterprise customers in terms of their biggest priorities and also their pain points when it comes to building and deploying AI application?
Ah, we get to AI now, of course, right? It's one of those things. We don't want to get kicked off the internet.
I think we made it 5 minutes.
Fair enough. So there's at least a couple of different ways to address this, right? So one is making sure our platforms are what I'll call AI ready, right? RHEL, we announced RHEL 10, right? So we almost don't talk about RHEL because, you know, we just take it for granted. But it's amazing because it's become like water now, right? It's a foundation now for so many enterprises, a foundation for our entire platform. So making sure that RHEL is the foundation for the AI platforms and supporting multiple, you know, accelerators, GPUs that can run on. Okay, we then want to make sure that we're also infusing AI into the platform. So when we had our announcement for RHEL this morning, we talked about how there's an intelligent assistant that's built on the decades of Linux experience that we have that customers can take advantage of, right? So, okay, the platform itself is AI-enabled and AI-ready. The platform itself, you know, works to bring the benefit of AI to its users. And then you carry that forward to say, well, what other new things can we do from an open perspective? I think you already had guests on today talking about the work on VLM and LLMD, and then the work we're also doing, for example, with Meta on Llama Stack, the work that we're doing to support MCP, Model Context Protocol, across the platform to really make AI much more consumable for the enterprise. So it's such a wide spectrum that we're trying to cover, but also making sure it builds on existing investments.
So why don't we not ignore RHEL and RHEL 10? Because you had some really interesting things around that, like the post-quantum encryption and image mode. And how does that really help customers today and into the future?
Yeah, well, with RHEL, which, you know, I know, Rob, you know this well, we have long lifecycle support for RHEL, right? Because customers are on it, you know, for periods of time because they're running mission critical application, we fully understand. It takes a while to upgrade. But at the same time, we want to make sure that we're giving them a platform that's preparing them for the future. So the work, for example, on the post-quantum, the support of the cryptographic algorithms and the libraries and frameworks we're bringing to bear for that, prepares them for that world. That world is not there today, but we want to make sure customers have confidence that the platform they invested in has that. Image mode for RHEL is another great example of advancement that we brought to the platform that actually builds on the investments most customers have made on the container front and say, hey, all of the value that you got from there, how about we apply that to upgradability, which is, you know, funny to say, right? You know, huge challenge still with operating systems, but bringing that way of working to operating systems, right? So that we use the analogy of a smartphone, right? You know, upgrading and updating an OS, right, should feel like, you know, what you're doing with your smartphones.
Just to follow up on that a little bit, because I think, and I'm going to steal a little thunder from the main stage tomorrow, I think. So not having seen it, but seen in some of the press releases, RHEL's also going other places. I've met up with the folks at CES that are doing some of the in-car stuff.
Right.
Kind of talk to that and how flexible you're looking, because to the comment that Rebecca had in the question around different, you have, it's not just, you know, IT folks that are running RHEL at this point as well.
Yeah, great point, Rob. So RHEL's available at this point pretty much anywhere enterprises want it deployed, right? So we see it traditionally data centers, we see it in every part of a public cloud. We see it on demand, we see it as subscription, but then we also now see it out to the edge, right? A skinny down version, the same RHEL, right, that you're used to, that you've certified against, now is out to the edge. You can see it here, right? You got a bunch of companies, essentially our ecosystem around edge, that are talking to the capabilities of using edge out, you know, to remote devices that will have, let's say, intermittent connectivity or constrained sets of resources. But they have the confidence that it's the same RHEL that they've built to in the data center that they can go take out to the edge.
Sure.
So as the chief product officer, how do you approach prioritizing your broad portfolio in terms of where you want to invest? I know you said you talked about being intentional about the customers themselves and where they want to invest and where they want to put their money and making sure it's tied to these actual business outcomes. But how do you think about it, especially when AI is just moving so incredibly fast?
Great question, Rebecca. And a difficult one to answer, and I don't want to be, you know, sort of facetious or light about it because we give it, you know, so much thought. There are some things that, you know, we have, I won't call it foresight, right, but we have line of sight into and that we feel confident in. In some other places, we are trying to work to create a market, right? So I'll lay both of those out for you. RHEL, right, is an area we know well. We've been doing this for 20 plus years. We know where we've been. We know the problems customers have. And then we know where we want to take it, right? Rob, to the question you asked, you know, out to the edge and all these other areas. Okay. Some places we react to. Virtualization is an amazing example of that. Who would have thought 2025 we're having this conversation about virtualization? But here we are, right? So be it, right? But we did have a core technology. We realized, wow, there's a lot of incoming market demand for it. Let's make some adjustments to make sure we can go serve that market fully, right? But we did that, right? We weren't expecting this many, and we said, here we go. Let's move, you know, engineering investment to go address that, and then, you know, obviously surround that with our ecosystem. Okay. Then AI is, it's very clear to us that there is interest in this market. Hey, we've seen the movie before with Linux and Kubernetes. There's going to be another one playing out in AI. We recognizing the kinds of, you know, challenges that we think customers will have when they want to run, you know, any kind of models. Right now, the pace of change in models is really fast, but we're like, hey, at some point, this will slow down. Then customers will come to us like, can you give me long life enterprise class support? Hey, can you make sure you're integrating with my existing data sets? We're like, we've seen every one of these patterns before. Why don't we work with Llama Stack and Meta, you know, to be able to support a standard set of APIs? Why don't we, you know, make sure we're supporting MCP to make sure customers have access to enterprise data and so on? So in those cases, right, we're working closely also to shape the market. LLMD is an example of us saying when folks are running inference at scale in a distributed environment, they're going to want a standard open way to do it. Why don't we work together with a huge ecosystem of partners to make that a reality? So, Rebecca, that's the balance that we try to make.
And the tension that you're working with, too.
Yes.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, exactly.
Again, because you cover so many different environments, from cloud hyperscalers, on-prem, colo, out to edge, where do you see people really building their AI? Because there's a lot of discussion about, you know, data gravity and bringing AI to the data at this point. Do you see it both ways? I mean, again, people doing massive training in the clouds, but then coming back on to do inference more locally, or?
I think at this point, the answer is probably all of the above. And I think that's a good thing, right? Because customers are essentially, you know, in open source, we would call this, you know, let a thousand flowers bloom. Right, the same idea to apply to AI, and then at the keynote I talked about, you know, 30% of projects fail, right? And so, yeah, or they don't make it from POC to production,
right?
So the question then for us is, what can we do to enable customers to become more successful? Serdar, and I don't know if he's coming on, of Turkish Airlines, he was on the keynote stage, and he had some great stories to tell, right, about the kinds of things he was doing, the work that they're doing, bringing data science to business folks,
right,
making sure that they can interact and engage with it more, making sure that, you know, each of these groups, if they want, they can have personalized agents to help them solve specific problems. And so this sort of world that we're moving to, this agentic workflow, this agentic future, we think is going to be super powerful, right? And will be very, very productive for enterprises. And we're just going to work to say, we'll provide you that platform for you, you know, the customer, to go, you know, make the experiments and then reduce the number of, you know, projects that are in failures, get more into prod.
So first of all, for the record, the Turkish Airlines executive will be on our show.
Right.
So yeah. we will be hearing about his journey. But I'm really interested in what you were just talking about there. As the CPO, you're kind of the rock star of the organization. And yet the culture around product has really changed in the sense that what you were just saying about bringing data science to the executives and making sure that everyone is much more involved in that perspective. How do you see your role having evolved, and how are you making adjustments to your product organization?
Yeah, well, I'll say first, right, the Red Hat culture is an open one. We're humble, and we're humble to the core, right? Our focus is on how do we serve the community, how do we serve our customers, how do we serve our ecosystem? And I think that's what we're trying to infuse across our entire organization, whether it's products, whether it's engineering, our sales teams. How do we best make sure that we're listening to get the feedback? Now, one of the things that we're trying to do, and that's also just trying to keep up, is increase the rate of change of how we develop. So I talked to an analyst in passing, and I'm sure you'll know him. I'm not going to use his name.
Yeah.
But he said, hey, I was just talking to someone like 3 weeks ago about MCP. And he says, I turn around, all these companies are now announcing their support of MCP. And he said, someone mentioned it's a de facto standard. He's like, how did that happen?
Yeah.
Right? Like from, you know, 3 weeks ago to now.
Right.
And so that rate of change, I think, is something that, one, we're trying to make sure we keep up with it. But then two, I think, Rebecca, you made this point. We try to make some conscientious or thoughtful choices to not put so much churn in front of our customers that they can't keep up with, right? So we're trying to do our best to balance that.
So just building off of that, I think one of the things is, to her question, was also around the personas that you have to build for. Because like you said, you know, OpenShift AI not only services the underlying infrastructure, but exposes things up to the data engineering teams, to data scientists and things like that. How have you gone about kind of squaring that circle a little bit to make sure that it's as simple as possible?
Yeah,
those personas.
Yeah. I think that's where we are trying to bring more of this, what I'll call the AI-enabled paths into the platform. Because in the past, I think we could make assumptions. Probably wasn't fair then, but we made assumptions, right? That, hey, someone using RHEL, for example, is a deep Linux sysadmin, you know, is a certified RHEL administrator, knows commands, loves a command line, right? And we, you know, we'll go. And then increasingly as we go forward, and we see this, right? In the presentation, we called it the Linux skills gap, but that skills gap is true across the board. How do you ensure that not just experienced seasoned folks, but the novices can engage with the platform? And what are they doing? They're all trained essentially working with like ChatGPT.
Right.
So it was like, you know, if I'll date myself, I'll be careful. When you had folks come in 10 years ago into the company, they said, hey, look, I use my iPhone. Like, I want everything inside IT, inside the company to feel like that. Now they're coming in saying, hey, I use ChatGPT for my school assignments. I expect the same to be available in the products I use. And so we're changing, we're evolving to bring that experience in, right, to make this more widely accessible.
Well, thank you, Ashesh. Always a joy having you on. Thank you so much.
Thanks again. Really appreciate it.
I'm Rebecca Knight for Rob Strechay. Stay tuned for more of theCUBE's live coverage of the Red Hat Summit and Ansible Fest. You're watching theCUBE, the leader in enterprise tech news and analysis.